is the Odyssey Church. This is not a test. This is the good news of Jesus Christ according to the doctor Luke. And today we're going to be looking at specifically Luke 3, verses 1 through 14, which we just saw on the screen acted out by those wonderful, wonderful actors. And I want to thank Rob and Tara for talking so long today, so when we go over today, that I can blame it on them and not on me. So thank you guys. I appreciate that so much. And I remember Romper Room, man. I don't know. I had to be under seven because we moved to Tennessee when I was seven. I remember being in the room. And do you all remember the magic mirror?
Yeah.
I looked through here and I see. If I was in my underwear, I was hiding behind the couch. I didn't want to see me. So, try to picture this in your mind. I try to picture this man carefully investigating everything he can, all the way back to the beginning, so that you and I, all of the Theophiluses of the world, so that we can know, so that we can be sure, so that we can be certain of the things which we've been taught, and the things which we have been written about, the things that are in these scriptures, the things that are in this Bible about God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Fact is, the scriptures tell us to walk by faith, not by sight, but we don't have to walk by blind faith.
That's right.
We can be certain, we can know for sure that what's been written in these Bibles and what's been written here is the truth, because they have been carefully investigated, they've been carefully written about in such a way and put in such an orderly account, and are so verifiable that there's no question about the authenticity of what's been written about this man we call Jesus Christ. This man who said that he was God in a body. This man who came from heaven and walked among his creation and walked among his people. That we can know for certain. And the question this morning is, if you want to know for certain, if you want to know for sure that you will enter into heaven's door, then Luke tells us, John the Baptist, how we can be certain that we'll enter into heaven's curtain. So we're looking at Jesus through the eyes of the doctor, Dr. Luke. And if you have those questions, and I think most of us do, because God said that He put eternity in our hearts, what will happen? How will I know when I leave this world and enter the next world, that I'll go to heaven and not someplace else? And Luke is going to tell us, and he's going to give us the proof of where we will spend eternity if we do what's according to his word. We can know for sure that we will enter into heaven's door. Now, as a trained doctor, this very educated man, this man named Luke, was very, very highly educated. But he speaks these truths as he writes this letter, and actually he doesn't even call it a letter, he calls it a book. In the book of Acts, he says, in my former book, meaning what we're talking about, the Gospel of Luke, we know that he's educated. The Greek in which he writes in has been studied as some of the finest Greek the world has ever seen. So he writes as we would expect a doctor to write, but in his education, he doesn't speak in terms that we can't understand. He writes it in simplistic terms so that we can understand exactly what he said. So what we find is that Luke was a traveling companion of the Apostle Paul. He never actually met Jesus. He never heard Jesus speak. He never saw the miracles of Jesus. But he walked alongside the Apostle Paul and gleaned from him. He knew the other apostle. He learned from Peter. He learned from Mark. He learned from John. He has more details. He has more miracles. He has more parables, more information about the life and the ministry of Jesus Christ than any of the other gospel writers. In fact, this book, what we call the Gospel of Luke, this book, this historical account of Jesus' life and ministry, is the longest book in the New Testament. He has more information and more words than any other writer. And in case you weren't here last week, we had a guest speaker last week. The famous Sherlock Holmes was here, and Sherlock Holmes carefully investigated the investigator and gave us the results of his findings. Now, if you weren't here last week, and your curiosity is sort of aroused, and you would like to know for certain that this man who says he's certain of things is actually certain of things, of the things that he's been taught, we carefully investigated and carefully wrote about, that they're true and verifiable. You can see last week's message on theodysseychurch.com or on our YouTube channel, or the easiest way to do it is to simply download our app, and that way you can watch it, and those are your friends, those are your family who may not believe the scriptures are reliable, can hear it with you. Now that message should be put up and able to be viewed sometime this week. But again, the easiest way to watch any of our messages that we've had here, there's only about three that are missing right now, we're hoping to have those up soon, is just download it on your cellular device. And then play it wherever you go or wherever you're at. And those who question the reliability, they can know for certain as well. This doctor Luke, he opens his book with an introduction. And that's a little different than the other gospel writers. He tells us exactly why he wrote the book. And he's writing to Theophilus. And Theophilus means lover of God. So in effect, he's writing to all of us who love God. He's writing to all of us who are lover of God. And Luke begins with an introduction as to why he's written his book. He says this: many people have set out to write accounts about the events that have been fulfilled among us. They use the eyewitness reports circulating among us from the very early disciples. They're using the report. You probably had a copy of Mark, who knew Jesus, who saw Jesus, but got most of his information from Peter. He probably had a copy of the Gospel of Matthew, possibly even the Gospel of John. Having carefully investigated everything from the beginning, I also had decided to write a careful account to you, most honorable Theophilus, so you can be certain of the truth of everything you were taught. So in other words, again, we can walk by faith, but we don't have to walk by blind faith. We can be certain of the findings have been confirmed by many, many modern-day archaeologists and historians. Last week we spoke specifically about a man named Sir William Ramsay, who set out on a 10-year mission to prove that Luke was a liar, to prove that Luke had fabricated. Because at the time that he was going on this 10-year journey, which was started in about 1880, most people believed the truths in the Bible, but they believed the cities and the villages and the things like that were just sort of made up. There was no historical evidence at that time that any of this took place. So Sir William Ramsay, in an early age, had been taught that the Bible was incorrect, inaccurate, you couldn't trust it. So he's setting out to prove Luke a liar, because if he can prove Luke a liar, then he proved the Bible is false and it can't be depended upon. But the exact opposite happened. When he began to see, and it's at the end of his 10-year investigation, at the end of his 10-year study in Asia Minor, in Turkey, in Greece, in Israel, not only did he find out that Luke was absolutely 100% historically accurate, but said he should be counted as one of the greatest historians of the world. And Sir William Ramsay, who was taught in his early age not to believe the Bible, not to believe in Jesus, became a follower, became a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. He became a believer because he now knew for certain what was in that word, what was in his Bible, was true and accurate. So, I want to be upfront this morning that the purpose, that the things I want to talk about, is that I want you to know for sure that you will enter into heaven's door. That's what the goal of today's message is. So that you can have the confidence, that you can be certain what it takes to get into and remain into God's presence for all eternity. I mean, really, isn't that why most of us are here?
Yeah.
I mean, we want to learn, we want to have confidence, we want to know for sure that Jesus Christ is who He says He is, and that we can depend upon and rely upon the fact that when we leave this world, that we'll be in a place in the next world where everything we've heard is true about, where there's no more tears, no more pain, that this eternal life is more glorious than we can even begin to imagine. We want to know for sure that we leave this world, that we'll hear the words of Jesus, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into your master's happiness and not hear these words come out of the mouth of Jesus. Throw that worthless servant outside. Throw that wicked, lazy servant into the darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And according to the scriptures, Luke clarifies and convinces us that what's written here is true. And the day we exhale our last breath of this temporary world and inhale our first breath of the eternal world, we will stand before Jesus and we will hear one of those two statements. And I don't know about you, but I want to enter into heaven's door. I want to know for sure where I'm hidden. So my goal this morning is very, very simple. I want you to be certain of the truths that are written in your scriptures. And I want to do that by using Luke's gospel. And we're going to be looking in the third chapter, chapter 3. And we're going to begin in verse 3, or verse 1. Like I said, Luke may be a doctor. And as we discovered last week, he writes in this language you'd expect by of a doctor. But Luke doesn't use words we can't understand. He wants us to be certain of everything that we're taught. So this highly educated man uses simple and easy to understand language to clarify and convince us that these truths found in these ancient scriptures, which have been preserved in some cases, in fact in most cases, for over 2,000 years, the New Testament for almost 2,000 years, and it's been organized and have been put into what we call our Bible. So I want to tell you up front, just in case, you know, you happen to fall asleep or you have to leave early, you start counting the lights in the room, or I want you to know for sure if you will enter into heaven's door. So my hope and my prayers this week, as I've been studying this and going through the words and studying other books, that Luke, the words that Luke has written, and through the power of the Holy Spirit, because I know it's not in me, that we can look at Luke's descriptions and look at our life and we can know whether we're following God's will for our lives, or if we're headed in the wrong direction, how we can turn around and go in the right direction. And Luke makes it clear as to how we can know for sure we'll either enter into or be thrown out of the kingdom of God when we meet Jesus face to face. And he uses what modern day psychologists might call the death system. D for describe, E for explain, S for specify, and C for consequences. So Luke describes what it looks like. He explains it. Then he tells us specifically what it's going to look like. And then he tells us the consequences if we don't do it. And then to drive it all home, he gives us a practical application. He shows us what it looks like in real life if we truly are following God, if we're truly a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, while you're turning to Luke chapter 3 in your Bibles, or on your cell phone, or on your iPad, or on your Kindle, or whatever you have this morning, I'm going to see if you're a movie buff, or possibly if you're over 25 years old. Does anybody remember the movie Runaway Bride? We had Richard Gere and Julia Roberts. And how does the movie open? With Julia Roberts, who plays a lady named Maggie Carpenter, on a horse, dressed in a wedding gown, running away from her marriage just as fast as she can. She's left her man at the altar, and she is getting out of town. We find out Maggie Carpenter is known as the runaway bride because she's left so many men standing in the same position. It's been rumored, as we find out early in the movie, that she has left 8 or 9 men in the same position. She's about to leave number 10 right there, even as the movie starts. See, here's the thing. Maggie Carpenter, she's gotten dressed in her wedding clothes. She's put on all her jewelry. She's gone to the church or wherever she's going to get married at, but she never goes through with the wedding. She's this beautiful, beautiful bride. She's ordained in her wedding clothes. She's okay. She's okay with the engagement. She's okay with the ceremony. She's okay with walking down the aisle. She's okay with going to church. But when it comes time to say I do, she doesn't. She says I won't, and she runs out the door. She's okay with the I will part. And she's okay with playing the part of the bride. She's okay with dressing up for the part and going to the church part. She's okay with the ceremony part. But when it comes time to commit, when it comes time for the I do part, she runs away. She doesn't do anything. She says, I will, but she never says, I do. And I really think there's a great picture of some Christians in this movie. Over and over again, those who follow Jesus and are the church, the body of Christ, we're called the bride of Christ in the Scriptures. And the Old Testament book of Hosea shows us as the unfaithful bride. The prophet Isaiah writes through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, your new name will be the city of God's delight and the bride of God. For the Lord delights in you and will claim you as his bride. The angel says in the book of Revelation, as told and recorded by John, let us be glad and rejoice and let us give honor to him. For the time has come for the wedding feast of the Lamb, and the bride has prepared herself. She has been given the finest of pure white linen to wear, for the fine linen represents the good deeds of God's holy people. And I wonder sometimes, is that how some of us come to church? You know, we get all dressed up, we get our Jesus story on, we get to the church with our church faces on, and we're ready for and we're okay with the ceremony. But truly, would we have the finest of linens on? Would we have the finest of pure linen to wear if that truly represents our good deeds, the things that we've done? I mean, have we just said, I will, but when it comes time to the I do part, we sort of say, I don't think so, and we run out the door and we hide? I mean, we're okay with the ceremony. We're okay with playing the part of the bride. It's the commitment we don't like. Do we sometimes act like Maggie Carpenter? We look like the bride, but we don't act like the bride. We look like the bride of Christ, we're all dressed up, we got to the church, we sing, I will follow Jesus. And when it comes time to actually be the bride, when it comes time for the commitment, the time to say I do, we don't, and we run. Today's message is to know that you can know that you can know if you're acting or if what the words that you confess are true. And this is important. This is really important. I know this is a tough message, and a lot of times in churches we don't preach tough messages anyway, because Jesus, who is God, says it, and again it's recorded by one of his closest followers in history, a man by the name of Matthew. In the Gospel of Matthew 15, it says, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. And then he says, their worship is but in vain. And their teachings are but rules of men. See, I think God wants more from us than just for us to say, I will. I think God wants us to say, I do. I believe God wants his people to say, I do, not I will. I believe God illustrates this and tells us this in no uncertain terms in the Gospel of Luke. But I also believe, and this is the good news, I also believe that God loves us so much that he loves us so much, he doesn't just tell us what to do, but he tells us how to do it, and then warns us of the consequences of what's going to happen if we don't, just as any loving parent would do for their children. Amen. I mean, as a parent, or as any leader, don't you tell people what you expect, and then you explain to them how to do it, and then you specify the intended result, and then you tell your child what the consequences are if they refuse? I mean, that's just simply good parenting. That's good leadership. That's loving in truth. And I hope you're going to see this morning, no matter where you are, no matter what you've done, in fact, no matter what you're doing right now, God loves you so much that He didn't just come to save you. He loves you much more than that. See, the key verse in the whole book of Luke, I believe, is found in the 19th chapter, verse 10. It says, "For the Son of Man came to seek and to save those who are lost." See, God loves you so much, He doesn't just hang you out there on your own. He loves you so much that He is seeking you, that He is looking for you so that you can be saved. And maybe you're in here this morning, maybe you're in here this very morning by the sovereignty of God because He is seeking you and He wants to save you from His wrath. God brought you here this morning because He wants you to hear what He has to say through these words of Luke, which Luke carefully investigated and carefully recorded so you could be certain, so that you could know for sure that you would enter into heaven's door. So Luke starts out by giving us the evidence of the truths in which he's writing about. He starts out by telling us about people who are just as real as your next door neighbor. These are people in history that you can verify and validate. Luke says, "It was now the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius, the Roman emperor, Pontius Pilate." We all know his name. He's the one that sentenced Jesus Christ to death. Pontius Pilate was governor over Judea. Herod Antipas was the ruler over Galilee. His brother Philip was the ruler over Iturea and Tachonitis. Licinius was the ruler over Abilene. Annas and Caiaphas were the high priests. Now, if you'd like to know some of the verifications of that, see me after the service. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that right now. But everything up there can be verified in history and has been verified in history.
Google it.
So be careful on Google, though, because they're going to sometimes... Annas and Caiaphas were the high priests. Caiaphas was the high priest. He was removed from office by Rome, and they put Annas in there. So some people will use that as a way to discredit the Bible. However, the Jews still recognized Caiaphas as the high priest because they didn't remove him. The Roman government did. But because Annas held the position of high priest, they recognized Annas as the high priest as well. So again, you know, there's some things in there that really take a lot of research, and I've done the research. I'm glad to go over it with you, and you can know for certain of everything that you've been taught. But what Luke is doing is he's actually giving us factual information. We can go back in history and verify the people. We can verify their positions. We can verify the locations. We can verify and validate the things that Luke's writing about so that we can be certain of the things that we've been taught. And as we saw last week, several prominent archaeologists, both in ancient history, back at the time that this was written, and in modern-day archaeology and historians, have done exactly that. They have verified this. But then Luke begins by showing us that we serve a God, and we have a God who always keeps His promise. He made a promise to the Jewish nation 760 years before. And Luke starts out by showing us that God is a God who always keeps His promise. A prophecy of God that is being fulfilled by a man we call John the Baptist, a promise of God which is coming to life, and there were eyewitnesses. Luke spoke to them. He read about them. But what makes this so significant is what Luke records next. He said, "At this time, a message from God came to John, son of Zechariah, who was living in the wilderness." Some translations say desert. "Then John went to place on both sides of the Jordan River, preaching that people should be baptized to show that they had repented of their sins and turned to God to be forgiven." Notice that it takes an action to be forgiven. It takes action. Not just words. It's more than saying Jesus is my Savior. You actually have to do something. You have to repent and turn to God to be forgiven. Now, when I said this is important, what's so significant about that? If you were to ask most people who the last prophet of the Old Covenant was, most people would say Malachi. Malachi is the last book, the last prophet written in our Old Testament. But Malachi was not the last Old Covenant prophet. last Old Covenant prophet isn't even recorded in the Old Testament. He's recorded in the New Testament. The last Old Covenant prophet didn't come until about 430 years after Malachi. The last Old Covenant prophet is John the Baptist. See, I don't know, this is what makes it so significant, is at this time a message from God came to John, son of Zechariah. See, the last Old Testament covenant was John the Baptist. Like all prophets of the Old Covenant, John did not get his authority. John didn't get his power from himself. He didn't get this prophecy in some kind of made-up way in his mind. He got his power, his authority, and his prophecy from God himself. The new covenant wasn't established until Jesus died on the cross. Remember Jesus' word at the Last Supper? They're recorded in Luke chapter 20, verse 20. He raises his cup up and he gives thanks to his Father. He said, this is the cup of the new covenant between God and his people. An agreement confirmed with my blood, which is poured out as a sacrifice for you. So John the Baptist is the last old covenant prophet. And I know you know this, but I'm just going to remind you anyway, because I had a lady one time say, well, I'm a Baptist because John was a Baptist. John wasn't a Baptist. We don't call him John the Baptist because he was a Baptist. You call him John the Baptist because he was baptizing people. Jesus hadn't died yet. Jesus hadn't even been started his ministry yet. There were no denominations. John is called John the Baptist because he was baptizing. But the interesting thing is John had a different baptism than what the people had ever seen before. And this made the religious leaders very, very angry. If somebody wanted to become a Jew, they got baptized. And the reason they got baptized was so the dirt and the scum of being a Gentile was washed off of them. They became ceremonially clean by being baptized. But that's not what John was preaching. And John was baptizing Jews, which had never taken place before. John was baptizing for repentance. John's baptizing was different. John went from place to place on both sides of the Jordan River, preaching that people should be baptized to show that they had repented. Strange word. It means to do an about face. It means to do a 180-degree turn. The Amplified Version writes this same verse this way. It says, repentance of heavy heart amending of their ways. A heavy, hearty amending of their ways with abhorrence. Abhorrence means extreme repugnance or extreme aversion. With abhorrence of past wrongdoings. Changing the way you think so you change the way you act. Change the way you think so you'll turn around and change your actions. Not being sorry about what you've done, but actually being, it bothers you. You're repugnant of what you've done. It's more than being sorry because you got caught. It's sorry enough to quit. To truly repent from sin means to commit yourself to the Lord in such a way that your life and your actions match what you proclaim. Your words and your behavior line up. In other words, let your lifestyle profess what your words confess. Let your lifestyle profess what your words confess. And I'm spending some time on repentance because we get it wrong so often. It's not just a matter of quit doing the wrong things. That would be impossible in human nature. It's a matter of the Holy Spirit helping you to do those things. According to Strong's expanded, exhausted concordance of the Bible, repent means to change the seat of moral reflection, to change one's mind or purpose. And specifically, because it's only used specifically here as it's used here in Luke chapter 3, verse 4, and again in verse 8, which we'll get to in a minute, but it means to turn from your sin and turn to God so your sin can be forgiven. I mean, it really does not get any simpler than that, but we all know that it's very easy to understand, but it's very, very hard to live out. It's a hard thing to do. But here we see that using that DESC acronym, that Luke has begun to describe the universal problem. And the universal problem is that we're all sinners. And we need to be saved from our sin. So he also now starts to explain to us how to turn from our sin and then specify what it looks like when we turn from our sin, when we repent and turn to God. And then he tells us the consequences of not repenting and turning from our sin. Then Luke's going to end all this by showing us exactly how we can apply this to our life, how we can apply the things that he's taught, these things that we can be certain of, so we can know for sure that we'll enter into heaven's door. And to sort of warm us up for this, what Luke does is he quotes from the Old Testament prophet Isaiah to give us an illustration of what we should do and what an effective ministry will look like if we're truly doing the things that God desires. He starts out by quoting Isaiah. Isaiah had spoken of John when he said, "He is a voice shouting in the wilderness. Prepare the way for the Lord's coming. Clear the road for him. The valleys will be filled and the mountains and hills made level. The curves will be straightened and the rough places made smooth. And then all the people will see the salvation that is sent from God." Now, the people in the period of history when Isaiah wrote these words, and the people in the time of history when Luke wrote these words would know exactly what they were talking about. And today we sort of lose it, but in a way we could apply it to what just happened in Washington, D.C. with the presidential election. Clear the roads. The valleys will be filled, the mountains and hills will be leveled, the curves will be straightened out, and the rough places made smooth. This was in preparation for an important dignitary coming to town. When the king or somebody very, very important was coming to a specific area, there was a messenger that was sent ahead of the person, and that person was to let everybody know that they were coming, and the roads had to be cleared, that the journey needed to be smooth on the way of this important person coming to their town. The valleys, the holes were being filled in the roads. The bumps were to be leveled out. The debris was to be picked up. The roads were to be made as straight as possible. The rough places made smooth. The pathway was to be cleared. The byways to be unhindered so the dignitary could be received with ease. Prepare the way for the Lord's coming. I mean, if we claim to be a Christian, that is our job. If we are a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ, this is our job, to prepare the way for the Lord's coming, to clear the roads, to fill in the holes, to level out the bumps, to straighten the curves, to make the rough places smooth, so that others will find it easy to receive the Lord. So that people can and will see Jesus Christ, the salvation sent from God. It's the mission statement right here at the Odyssey Church, to help people find and follow Jesus so they will go into a deeper relationship with the Lord. Our ministry is to be a forerunning ministry, a voice of one calling in the desert, the wilderness of today's world, preparing the way for the Lord so others may see salvation sent from the Lord, so others can see Christ. F.B. Meyer writes, "It's doubtful whether Jesus ever comes into the heart of mature manhood without the previous work of a John the Baptist." We're called, each one of us who claim to be a Christian, who say we're a follower of Christ, who say we're a disciple of Jesus, we're called to be John the Baptist. John prepared the way for the Lord. I'm called, you're called, the Odyssey Church, the body of Christ is called to prepare the way for the Lord. My ministry, your ministry, this church's ministry is to go before, to be the forerunner, to prepare the way, to make the path straight for the Lord Jesus so that others can find and follow him and see the salvation of the Lord. We're to model ourselves after John the Baptist as the ones who are crying out in the wilderness and the darkness of this world today. But Luke gives us this simple illustration of this effective ministry, but then he gets very, very deliberate. He said, when the crowds came to John for baptism, he said, "You brood of snakes, who warned you to flee God's coming wrath?" Now, this makes it look like John was talking to everybody in the crowd, and that's not the case. What we find out in Matthew's account and Mark's account, and this is sort of scary to me, is we learn that people were coming from all around Judea and Jerusalem to be baptized. There were lots and lots, hundreds of people that were coming, possibly thousands of people came to be baptized by John. But it wasn't these crowds of people who wanted to be baptized that John was speaking to when he said, "You brood of snakes, who warned you to flee from God's wrath?" It was the religious people. It was the church people. You know, the fact is, if you consider yourself to be a religious person, this is sort of be scary. Matthew tells us, Matthew chapter 3, verse 7, when he saw many Pharisees and Sadducees coming to watch him baptize. See, they weren't there to be baptized. They were there to police. They were there to make sure that what was going on was in accordance with what they thought should be going on. And when they found out, it says that John denounced them. He said, "You brood of snakes," he claimed, "who warned you to flee from the coming wrath?" John's calling the religious people a brood of snakes who are in jeopardy of receiving God's wrath. And don't miss what he's saying here. This is important. He's talking to the church people. In fact, in reality, he's talking to the church leaders. "You brood of snakes." See, in Genesis chapter 2, chapter 3, after Adam and Eve have sinned and God confronts Satan and he curses him, we read, "I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head and you shall bruise his heel." Once we have made Jesus Christ our Lord and Savior, he lives in us. And the Apostle John tells us in his first epistle, 1 John chapter 3, verse 9, God's seed, and he's very clear to what God's seed is, God's seed, Jesus Christ, abides or lives in you. We are God's children. We are co-heirs with Christ. When we repent, turn to God, and make Jesus our Lord and our Savior. But there's this enmity, there's this bitterness between Satan's seed and God's seed, between the children of God and the children of Satan. And John the Baptist had just told these religious people, had just told these religious church leaders that they are snakes. In other words, they are not God's children. They are from the seed of the snake. They are children of Satan, not children of God. John tells them, "You are in a bad way. You are in a rotten condition. That you're in jeopardy of receiving God's wrath." But notice, and this is so cool, this is so great, he doesn't tell them they have to stay in that condition. He doesn't tell them they have to stay as children of Satan. He tells them how to become and what it looks like to be called a child of God and have the seed of God living in them. The Pharisees and the Sadducees were the religious people of the day, and they were all dressed up. They'd go to the temple, they'd go to church. They loved the ceremony. They had said, "I will." But when it came time to repent and obey, when it came time to commit, they said, "I won't," and they ran for the door faster than Maggie Carter in her wedding dress. They were more concerned about the praises of the people than they were the praises of their God. They loved to look the part of the rock. They liked to please the crowds. But when it came time to please the groom, they didn't say, "I do." They said, "I don't," and ran for the door. Is that the way some of us treat God? We like the engagement. But when it comes time for the marriage, when it comes time for the commitment, we're going to let somebody else do that. And here's the thing, if by the end of this message, you begin to realize this may be you, you begin to realize that you've said, "I will," but you have never committed and said, "I do," then there's good news for you this morning. I want you to know that. If any time this morning you begin to think to yourself, "I may be a child, I may be a seed of the serpent, not a child of God, a seed of the Savior," if you realize right now that you're in a bad way, you're in a rotten condition, "I'm in jeopardy of receiving God's wrath," I want you to know you do not have to stay a child of the serpent. You don't have to remain a seed of the serpent. Our Lord Jesus Christ, our God, thinks you are to die for. Yes. He loves you so much he sent his Son to die in your place for your sins. And let's look at what Luke tells us next. Prove by the way you live that you have repented of your sins and turned to God. prove by the way you live that you have repented of your sin and turned to God. God loves each person in this room so much. He loves you. He loves me too much not to tell you the hard truths. I love you too much not to tell you the hard truth. He says your natural tendency, the nature of your heart, is to turn away from me, that you are in a bad way, you are in a rotten condition. But because of God's great love, you don't have to stay that way.
Amen.
Yes, Luke has described to us our condition, but he's now explaining to us how we can know for sure we will enter into heaven's door. He says the way to know for sure is to be, the way to know for certain is to look at your own life. Have you repented of your sins? Have you turned from your selfish ways and your selfish desires and turned your life in the direction of God? If not, if you said, I will, then you need to prove that you want to be the bride and say, I do, by proving, by the way you live, that you repented of your sins and turned to God. See, the fact is, we're all born in a bad way. We're all born in a rotten condition. Paul writes his letter to the Christians in Rome, and he tells us, and he's actually quoting from Old Testament scripture, so this isn't something new. It's always been this way. As it is written, no one is righteous. Not even one. All have turned away. All have become useless. No one does good. Not a single one. He says, you're in this terrible way. You're in this rotten condition, for the wages of sin is death. But the fact is, God loves each one of us. He loves you and He loves me so much to leave us as seeds of the serpent. He sent His Son, not just to save us, but to seek us. So Paul goes on and says, and I thank God he does not end that sentence with the wages of sin is death. He goes on to say, but the free gift of God's eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. We don't have to remain as seeds of the serpent. We can become a child of God with His seed living in us, but it's more than just words. It's our actions which tell us which one we are. God is telling us, each one of us, to prove by the way we live that we have repented of our sins and that we have turned to God. And God, through John, through Luke, through Matthew, through John the Baptist, warns us that this is a personal decision. No one, and by no one I mean no one but you, can decide whose seed you're going to be. Verse 9. Don't just say to each other, we're saved, but we are descendants of Abraham. That means nothing. For I tell you, God can create children of Abraham from these very stones. Your mama and your papa's salvation can't save you. It means nothing to you. No excuses. You can't get into the kingdom of heaven because your mama and daddy repented and had you baptized as a child. You can't get into the kingdom of heaven because they repented, because they were Christians. It's like going to go get a haircut. You got to go yourself. You can't send somebody else. You got to end up at the barber yourself. John was using baptism to show these Jewish people that they needed to commit on their own. They had to do something themselves. They couldn't rely on their ancestry to Abraham to get them through the doors of heaven. It takes more than a public ceremony like being baptized or coming to the altar at the end of a service. It takes more than raising your hand or signing a card or bowing your head with all eyes closed and no one looking around to be saved from the wrath of God. Now, I want to let you know, those things are important. We shouldn't neglect those. That is an outward showing of an inward faith. But it doesn't save you. The ceremony never saved you, no more than animal sacrifices saved the Jews in the Old Testament. Prove by the way you live that you repent of your sins and turn to God. Prove by the way that you live that you've gone farther than Maggie Carpenter in a wedding gown. Don't say I will, you have to say I do. So Luke, getting back to our death system, has described to us our condition. And it's not pretty. We are, before we make Jesus Christ our Lord and Savior, and remember, it's not just Savior, that's the I will part, but we have to say I do, that's the Lord part. We say I will, we say I do, and before that, we're in a terrible way. And Luke explains to us what we need to do to be children of God and not children of the serpent. To have the seed of God living in us and not the seeds of Satan. That is to show that we have repented of our sins and turned to God to be forgiven of our sin. And Luke has specified how we can know for sure that we'll enter into heaven's door. Prove by the way you live that you have repented your sins and turned to God. In other words, our lifestyle to profess what our words confess. Now Luke begins to tell us the consequences of not repenting, of not turning to God, of remaining a child of the seed of the serpent. And Luke speaks with much urgency. Even now as I speak this message this morning, right now, even now, the axe of God's judgment is poised, ready to sever the roots of the trees. Yes, every tree that does not produce good fruit will be chopped down and thrown into the fire. This is a warning the Holy Spirit has inspired Luke to say. What the Holy Spirit is telling us is God expects us to be obedient. God requires us to keep our vows. And when we say, I will, God truly expects us to follow through and say, I do. And if we don't, there will be consequences. And we may not know when those consequences will happen. We may not know when those consequences will take place. But God's judgment is poised at this very moment, even now. God expects us to produce fruit in order to prove we have repented and turned our lives from our own selfish directions to His light, His divine direction, to avoid the consequences of His wrath and judgment. The first step is repentance. Turn your thinking around so you'll turn your actions around. You have to admit you're lost before you can find your way and get back on the right path, right? You don't know you're lost until you find out you're lost.
That's true.
Luke calls for an action. He says mere lip service ain't going to cut it with God. You can't just say you're a Christian. God expects you to be obedient. He expects you to resist temptation. He expects you to actively serve and help others, to share your faith. But in order to do this, Luke said, if you aren't producing any fruit in your life, you're going to be chopped down and thrown in the fire like a farmer would a tree that's not producing any fruit. Apple tree produces apples. A pear tree produces pears. Christians are to produce Christians. Second part of our mission statement. Disciples that make disciples that keep on making disciples. That's how we got to today, 2,000 years later. The message of the cross should have died with Jesus on the cross. But it didn't, because disciples took action and went out of the world and preached the good news of the gospel, and we're to do the same thing. The message of repentance is good news to those who say, I do, and listen and seek forgiveness from a loving God who's full of grace and mercy.
Amen.
But it's terrible news to those who only say, I will, and then don't do anything about it. Have you repented of your sins? If you say you have, can others see the difference in your life? A changed life, listen to this, a changed life with new and different actions makes repentance real and visible to the world. A changed life is your outward and visible sign. It is your wedding ring to show you belong to God. And Luke gives us strong warning, strong conflict right, with those who call themselves Christians and then do nothing about it. God wants the I do's, not the I will's. God wants the commitment. He tells us we can't make excuses and we can't rely on the works of others. We have to do something ourselves.
Amen.
Folks, I know this is a tough message, but I love you too much not to speak the truth. Luke compares those who aren't committed, the I will's, but don't, the trees which bear no fruit and will be cut down and burned in a fire. And I think we all know what he's implying there. And I know a lot of people, and I've met a lot of people who look like and they call themselves Christians, but they bear absolutely no fruit. And John the Baptist says Jesus is coming to separate those that say I will from those who say I do. From those who say I will but don't, from those who say I do and then take action. Those who repent and believe and commit and turn to God and show it by a transformed life, those who prove by the way they live that they repent of their sins and turn to God, they will be saved. But for those who don't, those who say I will but run and say I won't, they will be punished. And this should scare us all. But we're not alone in that. It scared the people. It scared the people that were in the crowd that day. They listened to this. And then through John the Baptist, God shows us what to do. What the proof of our repentance life looks like. After we turn to God, what does it look like? How do you bear fruit? I mean, that becomes a question, right? Okay, Lord, I know I'm supposed to bear fruit, but I don't know how. This is the practical application for our life. The crowds asked. I mean, they were scared. He heard this message. They're like, man, what do I do? What should we do? John replied, if you have two shirts, give one to the poor. If you have food, share it with those who are hungry. Even corrupt tax collectors came to be baptized. Now, that's amazing if you know the story of tax credit. And asked, teacher, what should we do? He replied, collect no more taxes than the government requires. What should we do, asked some of the soldiers. If the tax collector surprised you, the soldier should be even more surprising. John replied, don't extort money or make false accusations and be content with your pay. What's Luke saying? What's God saying through the Holy Spirit in these verses? How do we prove we repent and turn our lives to God? How does it look in our lives so that we'll know for sure that we're going to enter into heaven's door? And really, I read these verses, and at first they were like, yeah, there's words. But then as I began to break it down, it's just so simplistic. We love God and we love others.
That's right.
The proof of how we live our lives is how we treat each other, isn't it? How we serve each other. Even those we find hard to serve and to treat well. He says, this is what you do. You love people. You take care of the poor. They don't have enough clothes, you give them clothes. You feed the hungry. You don't lie, cheat, and steal. Be fair in your dealings with others. Be content with what you have and don't cheat others out of what they have. And notice some of the people, they turn the worst professions, the most hated people of their time, the dreaded tax collectors. They were corrupt. They had their own category of sin. Jesus would say, you sinners and you tax collectors and prostitutes. I mean, they were so bad, Jesus put them in their own category. People hated them. They considered them to be traitors. Traitors to their people, traitors to their country, traitors to their religion. But even the hated, dreaded, corrupt tax collectors weren't as bad as the Roman soldiers. I mean, the Roman soldiers in the crowd that they had probably killed or at least extorted money out of people that the Jewish people in the crowd knew that day that they loved. The Roman soldiers were the occupying army. And Jesus says, you know, just don't extort from people. I find it so amazing to me because you would think Jesus say, don't be a tax collector anymore. Don't be a soldier anymore. But he never told him to quit his job. He said, go back right where you're at. Go back to your job, but do it honestly. Treat people good. You can be a tax collector. Just don't collect any more money than you're supposed to. You can be a soldier. Just don't extort people. Don't treat them unfairly. Be content with what the government's paying you. Don't go steal it from other people. He didn't say go into full-time ministry. He didn't say get on your cart and buggy and go into the mission field. He said you can be a minister of Christ exactly where you're at. In the job. You don't have to change vocations. Just treat people like you want to be treated. Love God with all your heart, your mind, your soul, and all your strength. And treat others as you want to be treated. And if you'll do that, then you'll be loving others. And by your love, you'll be known as my disciples. Be a witness to even the other hated tax collectors and the other Roman soldiers by proving by the way you live that you repented of your sins and turned to God. Repent, turn to God, produce fruit, and then let your lifestyle profess what your words confess, or profess what your words confess. How can you know for sure that you will enter into heaven's door? Number one is you have to repent from your sins. Number two, you have to turn to God, which means turning away from your selfish desire. Now, it doesn't say you can't have stuff. Some of the richest people the world has ever known are found in Scripture, and they were people of God. But they served God first, and God gave them the desires of their heart. And bear good fruit. Let your lifestyle profess what your words confess.
You know, back to the Runaway Bride movie, as it turns out, Maggie Carpenter, the reason she was the runaway bride, the reason that she always ran when it came to the time to say I do, is that she was scared. The reason she wouldn't commit was that she was sort of lost. You know what finally got her to commit? It's the same thing that gets us all to commit. I mean, you're not going to be happy in a marriage just because it's the right thing to do. I mean, you could be, but you're probably not going to be. You're not going to be happy in a marriage where somebody else has told you you have to get married. It's possible, but it's not likely. The way to be happy when you say I do is to love the one you're saying I do to. And when Maggie Carpenter finally fell in love, she was able to say, I do. When she finally fell in love, she became committed. And so will we. When we truly fall in love with Jesus Christ, when we truly fall in love with God, we will say, I do, and we will become the bride of Christ. But even in Maggie Carpenter's story, it took her a while. She said, I will. But it took a while to get to the I do part. Maybe that's where some of you are this morning. When you said I will a very long time ago, but you've never said I do. And you love Jesus. You're just afraid of the commitment to Jesus. Because you know it's going to take some changes in your life. Just as when you get married, it's going to take some changes in your life. Can't always do the things you used to do, and you have to start doing some new things that you weren't doing. Maybe like one of the people one day who told me, you know, I just don't do anything because I'm afraid I'm going to let people down. I don't know if I can follow through with this. Well, how can you know unless you try? And I know it's hard. I don't make any pretenses about it. I know it's hard. I know it takes you out of your comfort zone. And that's why the Odyssey Church wants it makes it easy on you. We want to help you to help people find and follow Jesus. We want to make it easy for you to say, I do. Just take a moment, if you will, and think about this. Think about this. What would your life look like? What would your family look like if you committed to I do instead of just saying I will? How would your life look like? Do you think that maybe, just maybe, you'd be living life and living it more abundantly? I mean, it's nice to know for sure that we'll enter into heaven's door when we die. That's not the only reason Jesus came. He said, I came to give you abundant life now. He said, I gave you come so you can have more in the afterlife and this life. How would your family look? How would your friends look? How would your workplaces look? If you went from I will and blending in with the crowd to I do and proving by the way you live that you've repented and turned your life to God. And would it be more abundant? Do you think maybe that you would begin to bear good fruit if your life proved by the way you live, you'd turn to God and family, and your friends, might even come to know Jesus in a more personal and more intimate way? Do you think if we all said I do instead of
I will. We could take our ordinary lives and make them extraordinary. Do you think the world would be a better place if we were clothing the poor and feeding the hungry? If we were fair in our business and our personal dealings? We were being honest and speaking the truth? Do you think if we all said, I do, and became the bride of Christ, we could impact our workplaces and our community, our families, our children, all for the glory of God? What if we fell in love with Jesus, said I do, and became the bride of Christ, and prepared the way for the Lord by making the rough places smooth for those who want to find and follow Jesus and go into a deeper relationship with God? So that others could see the salvation that's sent by God. So that others could see Jesus the Christ. Maybe it's time to stop running. Maybe it's time to go from I will to I do this morning. Maybe there's somebody this morning that would like to commit to becoming the bride. By simply saying I do. By proving by the way you live that you've repented of your sins and you've turned your life to God. As I told you earlier, come to the altar doesn't save you any more than the animal sacrifices did in the Old Testament. But it is an outward and visible sign of an inward belief. So if that's you this morning, make it public. Come to the altar and allow somebody here to pray with you. Maybe like you got like me one day, you know. Called myself a Christian. I was trying, but really I was just playing a game. Go to church on Sunday and do everything I wanted to do on Monday. Got tired of playing the game. Maybe today somebody here got tired of playing the game. Just playing the part of the bride. Never actually committed to being the bride. Do you want to know for sure on the day that you die, you'll hear these words come from the mouth of Jesus? Well done, good and faithful servant. Come and share your master's happiness. And then enter into heaven's door. Make it public. Improve your desire to produce good fruit. Have you said I will? Maybe this morning after hearing the words of John the Baptist, you know that you might be considered among the broods of snakes. Now you want to be known as a child of God with the seed of God living in you. Would you be willing to make a public outward sign of that inward belief? Just want you to know this morning that you can leave here this morning knowing for sure that you will enter into heaven's door. Just repent of your sins. Turn to God. And bear good fruit. And the proof will be by the way you live. By the way you treat and serve others. Let your lifestyle profess what your words confess. Please allow me to pray for you. Oh, Heavenly Father, dear Lord, we pray for the one who is here this morning. The Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. The triune God, three in nature, one in person. The one who is here right now in our midst. Father, we ask that you empower us to praise you, not with words, but with actions that come from outside of us, but with that which is within us, the seed which dwells and abides in our hearts. Dwell with us this morning more fully that we may sing to you with all our heart. That you'll fill us with a sense of your joy. That we might actually delight in your worship. Focus upon your love, which is above all that we have ever known. Father, make your love and your presence so real to us this morning as we leave here. And Father, we ask all of this in the name of our risen Savior, Jesus the Christ.